So thank you very much for being here. As you can notice, I have two laptops with me because this is my old laptop, which I know that works with HDMI, and my new laptop, which I didn't try yet. I tried it now and it doesn't work. So I have my spare laptop, which should be enough. The only thing is that, well, I prepared this talk on my new laptop, but all should be okay. If not, please forgive me. So, however, what the subject of the talk is, as you can see, with this beautiful sheet, ASCII art that, well, it's not a slide, so. No, okay, it's something like a little cheating, but, well, it's at least a title, and I'm Marco Piraccini, but, and this is NoSlidesConf 2016. But, well, the subject of this talk is profiling and debugging with Node.js. I'm a Node.js developer, I'm a software architect, but also, of course, a developer. This is a topic that is, you know, quite important in every programming language. And it's something that, Node is quite low level. I mean, you launch Node with the console, and there are a lot of parameters that you can use with the V8 engine. And so, well, it's something that is not so well detailed. Also, there is a lot of new stuff continuously on Node world and on JavaScript world. You know, I'm talking about this today, maybe in 2 months is completely different. And well, I'm pretty comfortable with that, but I can understand that JavaScript world is very quick, which is good from a point of view, can be problematic for other point of views. However, in general, I'm not a big fan of debugging, so we start talking about debugging and the options that we have. Then we talk about profiling. Of course, since at the rule of this conference, I must show something. And then I will end with some memory profiling. And but in general, I'm not a big fan of debugging. I'm one of the old school guys that don't use IDE. I use usually console log or system out in Java or anything, and I'm pretty comfortable with that, but it's not possible every time, because sometimes you have you need something much powerful because of the complexity of the code, or because we are using some intermediate software. So let's start with an example application I wrote, which is this one app. It's a very stupid application. So first of all, let me remove some useless stuff. Yes, okay. And let's take a look at this software. This is basically an HTTP server. I used a quite common library, which is HAPI, happy, like happy, but happy. And I like it very much, but it's not a subject of this talk. I use it because, well, it's simple. So I assume that you are comfortable with JavaScript. If not, it's not a big issue, because the application is, well, kind of stupid. It exposes two different endpoints. The first one, which is exposed on /API/info path, and as connected an handler. This handler calculates a tag, an e-tag, using a function called superHash, which is a function that calculates a superHash. And, well, then save something and do a reply of a file, which is a package.json, but is a JSON description of the project, and an e-tag. And then this route serves all the static stuff, nothing more, except the start of the server and my awful superHash function, which is a function that is very stupid, by the way, because is a for loop which concatenates 3,000 times 3,000 hash, calculated every time on the previous hash. So, of course, there is no sense in it except of showing you something on the tools that we are going to use, because it's a very, very stupid code. So, let's start the application. Well, the application simply runs. I forgot to show that there is also a small client part, which is very stupid also. Is a simply React component. And I've done that because I want to show you something later. But. So if we launch it, and let's say that we open the URL, so HTTP is on 4000 port, okay. Okay, this is the dumb React component, but much interesting is the API, so /API/info, which, well, in this case, there is an error, is intentional, so HTTP 500, and is, well, it's an error that we are going to, in some way, to correct. How we can do that? Let's start with debugging. There is already a debugger which is shipped with Node.js, but doesn't have a GUI. But we can use it command line. So let's try it. This is very simple, very, very low level, but it's present. So we can use it. And as you can see, well, we simply added the debug param and it started. The debugger started listening on the 5858 port, waiting for connection, and then breaks. So it's currently waiting for an action, which I have to do. In this case, if I ask for the API, well, no one is answering because the server is not up yet. So what I can do? There are some commands, so I can go next, and so on. So it's much better to run. So now it's running. Sorry, and now it should answer. Is not. Why not? Run. Restart. Okay. Help. Okay, yeah, continue, of course. So server running at port 4000, which is and now we have the same result because the code is still buggy. So what we can do, very, very few, by the way, because it is very low level. So what we can do, for instance, is that we can set up a breakpoint. We can do that with the command that we already seen, but for instance, we can put here a debugger line. Let's save it and run it again. Continue, okay, it's running at port 4000. Okay, now we are on the breakpoint. We can go next. And well, we know that here we have some kind of bug, we have an error, and so on. So it works, of course, but I think that no one ever used it seriously because it's very low level. I've seen a couple of projects done to give a more proper interface for this debugging. Yes, you can do stuff, you can add watch and watch variable and so on, but actually it's not so useful because of the command line interface. So since it as you can see, when you run it, well, you see that there is an address with the port 5858. Is because actually is exposing a port, and you can interact with it using a TCP protocol. I don't know if it's actually still valid, the documentation, because I take a look last week, and it's quite seems to be quite deprecated, but it's something that is or was public. And so, leveraging this, it's possible to have other debugging tools. For instance, one popular option was Node Inspector. Node Inspector is a tool that, well, I already installed. By the way, the current version doesn't work out of the box in Linux, so I had to do a small tweak for that, but there is no sense in explaining that right now. When you install it globally, and you use node minus debug instead of a node, or node with param debug, and server JS. Okay, you don't see that because I was in the other page, but actually Chrome opened here, where we have our code. So it's the same that we had in console, but well, we see the code, we can put some breakpoints directly, that way, for instance. It starts stopped, so I have to run it, and now it's running. And we have the console here, so. Where is it? Too much Windows open. So what we can do, for instance, well, debugger listening on port, perfect. Let's try it. So HTTP 4000 /API/info, and well, it's blocked here because we have debugger. I can remove it. I can go on and stops on the breakpoint that I set on my directly on the code, and then I can run, and at the end it will give the error again because well, the code is still buggy. So as you can see, well, we have the code, we have the ability to stop, to go into go leave a function, the user stuff that you are used to in normal debugging tools. What we cannot do is to edit files. So we have something that is very much like an IDE, but is not is Chrome. Actually, there is the ability, the possibility of changing code. Indeed, we can add folder. But I don't know why, sometimes I have to, okay, no, not here. I will do that, next point. So, this is something that is more interesting than the console level debugger, but still is the same thing seen inside inside Chrome. And is the old way of not debugging. Indeed, there is a new option which comes with Node V6, so it's quite recent, which is -- inspect. If we launch Node -- inspect, well, something slightly different happens. So, again, debugger listening on port, but on different port. Then a warning. This is an experimental feature and could change at any time, but we are JavaScript developers, so doesn't scare at all. It's normal, and everything changes every day, so usually I don't even read it. And then it says, okay, to start debugging, open the following URL in Chrome. So let's open the following URL in Chrome. can open here. Debugger attached, you see. So in some way, there is a sort of communication between Chrome dev tool and my Node.js process. I can see again the code, and the same log on both the console on which I launched Node.js and on dev tool console. Indeed, if I change something, so for instance, nano server JS, but let's remove this and put a console log requested or something, just to see some log. Okay. Okay, now the as you can see, the code has been updated. Let's invoke the buggy API. And we see first requested and then the stack trace, the same that we have in our console. So we have the same log. So as I was saying before, it would be interesting to add the code, the ability of edit the code in our application. And you can do that adding the workspace. Of course, for the browser limitation, Chrome asked me if I want to allow Chrome and or DevTools to access file system. I'll do that. And now I see my project here and my code. This is interesting because, well, now I can change it. I saved it. Let's see if the code has been changed here. It is. Yes, okay. So if I launch it, well, I had to reconnect DevTool, but there is a WebSocket, so also DevTool see that the process ended. And if I launch it, well, I have, of course, the changed behavior. So now what we can do is, well, correct the source because is something that we want to fix. What we have here, we have a couple of bugs. The first bug is that this is reversed, of course. I'm doing the check in the wrong place in my for loop. And, well, I think that this... is null, so ret is null. I concatenate ret with hash ret, hash entity, entity to string. I cannot, of course, so that's the reason of cannot read property to string of null. Okay. Is the for Java developers, is the like a null pointer exception. By the way, there are some Java developer here. Okay. Me too. I'm a Java developer. So also. So, well, here we have the solution, because I'm lazy, so I don't want to make too much reasoning. Also, this is one of the latest, talks in talks today, so I think that you are lazy, but I'm sure that I'm quite lazy, quite tired also. So let's correct in that way and see if is now working. So let's relaunch it, reconnect the tool. The code has been corrected, and okay. This is simply a file that we have in our folder. Is this one, require package.json. But the point is that it answered correctly. And again, we have requested in console. What has been returned? Let's make a quick investigation. We see that the time is quite slow because it's 300 milliseconds. And we should see our beautiful network headers tag, which is totally crazy, of course, but is intentional. Okay. So we started from the very low level console, the log, the bug. Then we added node inspector, which is kind of deprecated because of the new parameter, V8 parameter. And with this, well, we can do the same that node inspector. So if you look in an internet blog post or tutorials that say to use node inspector, today there is no so much sense in doing it. However, we can do more. There is a new experimental feature, quite experimental, of DevTool that allows to. Let's connect here to the application. If you go to the settings and experiments, you see some options that are unchecked. To activate these experiments menu, you have to configure a further flag on Chrome configuration. But I already done that in my Chrome. One thing I don't know, so I have to check if that I have to use a Chrome beta, not the last Chrome, is not enough. Or Canary, if anyone has it. So let's make sure of opening the right one. So again, API info. So it's something very, very experimental. Here, this I love this. I have to click 6 times shift and well, we see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Some magic options that you, it's like the old time the cheats in video games, you know, that the secret menu. And well, there is a beautiful node debugging, you see. So you click it, you restart DevTools, and in source, now you know that there is a beautiful node element and the usual client stuff. So why is this interesting? Because as I said, we have actually a React component which do nothing, simply prints hello, NoSlidesConf. But we see that in the code we have a console log. Here, this one. And since we are in DevTool, opened with Control Shift E in DevTool, well, it puts, write the outputs on the browser console log. But what it's interesting that in our application, we have also an HTTP endpoint, which is server side, so on Node, and it should. Indeed, it do that, but I don't know, it's disappeared. Okay, we see both logs. So node logs, which actually are running here, and browser logs in the same tool. Again, this is very experimental, doesn't work every time, so hopefully in some month we will have it in all Chrome. And it's interesting because I can debug both client-side JavaScript and server-side JavaScript inside Chrome, which is also interesting because you know that with some JavaScript technologies like React and server-side rendering, well, there is no so much difference anymore between what is in the browser and what is on the node side. However, I just want to show you this because from my point of view it's quite interesting even if I don't use it because it's quite buggy yet. As you can see, we have to know the secret cheat to activate it. Okay. So we know how to debug, at least some traditional, very low-level technique. I didn't say that, but I'm intentionally skipping the IDE, like WebStorm and all this stuff, because, well, first, I don't use it. Second, is something like, even if WebStorm is a good thing, it's a product, so I don't want to make some kind of... So I just used what is... I'm just using what is inside inside Node, or it's completely free. So let's then assume that, let's assume that we are good with debugging, and now, well, we've seen that our application, our endpoint is, well, very slow. This is a huge amount of time. So we need some profiling. Profiling, especially CPU profiling, is very important in Node.js because you know that Node.js is single-threaded from the in the user space, from the user point of view. So if you have something that is using a lot of CPU, probably you are blocking all the application. A couple of years ago, I worked on an application that was making a had to produce a PDF. The operation was quite heavy, something like 3 or 4 seconds. And in a Node application, this is a problem. This is an issue because for 3 or 4 seconds, the Node is blocked producing this. So, of course, we can find some kind of workaround for that. But the point, my point is we have to avoid this. And the first step to avoid this is to identify this. So, what we are going to do now is to identify the, these bottlenecks, which can be done analyzing the, well, we can do a statical analysis. In this case, it's very easy because the application is very stupid and the problems are obvious. In other, more realistic cases, it's not so easy. So the usual strategy is to analyze dynamic behavior. So, what we can do? First of all, we need a way to create some sort of load, because we what we want is to analyze the performances, the performance of the software, but not of a single request. We have a couple of options for doing that. One is Apache Bench. Another one is one tool called AutoCannon. I don't know if you already heard about that. It's basically is a Node tool which is similar to Apache Bench. It's some sort of create some load on an HTTP endpoint. So we specify the connection. We specify the duration, which is 10 seconds, but is the default, and the URL. So, and a lot of other options that we are not going to use it today. So, if I launch it, we see that here in this tab we have the application with the request, and on the other tab we have the AutoCannon running. So. At the end, of course, print some statistic, and we actually executed the application with some realistic load. Okay, now we know how to create some traffic for our HTTP API. Let's see what is bundled in Node for profiling. There is another V8 option, which is not inspect but prof, minus minus prof, prof, and we can use it. Let's see what happens. Basically, still nothing. Let's launch AutoCannon and wait for a minute. Okay, this is the folder. We see that there is one log, which is a V8 log. We can stop it now. And is quite big, is 6 megabytes. And is the profile log from V8. We can open it, for instance, with this text editor. And is something that, well, I don't understand. Is a very low level. It's something that is for V8 specialist, and is not so useful right now. So we must have a way to, well, obtain more useful information. Fortunately, there are a couple. The first one is that is included in Node a processor, which is which you can, activate with this other V8 option, which is minus prof minus process. So it's something that is embedded in Node. I'm using Node 6.5, just for information. So if you are using older nodes, which I don't suggest, by the way, I don't know if this is actual. I think so about prof, but I'm sure that, for instance, inspect is not working before Node 6. So we can process it, and we can create out txt. And then we have out txt, which is better. It's not enough from my point of view, but well, we have some information. So statistical profiling result from and the number of the file, the number of the ticks, and so on. There are some sections, so shared libraries, JavaScript, again, still too much low level, C++, and a summary, which is not so clear from my point of view, because I'm not, I'm still not looking exactly what is doing my application. So, okay. So I need something more, more explicit. Fortunately, there is a tool which is a flame graph generator called 0x. A flame graph is a graphic, which I'll show you shortly, which is quite interesting because it shows you the time spent that a function spends for the CPU. So basically, you see how much a piece of code is using CPU, but let's see it. So to use it is still something that we have to install globally. So 0x, I already installed it. To use it on Linux, you need to install perf. Yes. Which is not so easy because, for instance, I had to compile the Linux kernel tools, but it's necessary. While in Mac, on Mac, should work out of the box. However, 0x node and then server. When I launch it, it requires my password. And if I stop the process, it says, okay, cook the sigint, and then, well, create an HTML with my flame graph. So now I've done that without any load. Let's create some load, of course. So launch it, and autocannon again. So we see that something is happening. Autocannon is firing my HTTP endpoint, and then generating flame graph. First, it generates this file. See, is quite big, and then process it, producing a JSON file, still quite big, which I don't. Not the content, but it's not important because what I want is this one. Let's change the theme. In this case, the flame graph is quite stupid. I know that because usually there are more flames. It's called in that way because you see that, well, here you have the full CPU time. So there is no time on horizontal axis. The horizontal axis is the percentage of CPU time used. And we see that for the let's click here for the 30 for the test data function, which is as you remember this one. Is the handler of the HTTP API. Well, it took, it was, the 35% of the time on the stack, because basically it was doing this. And specifically, you can see that super hash and hash were the real functions that were keeping the CPU busy. Again, this is very stupid because the code is stupid, but it's interesting because in that way, you can see immediately, simply looking at the width of the of those flames, which is actually the function that is using CPU time. And so we can, well, okay, we see, okay, we have a problem here, and here. So let's look at the code. Okay. The code is dumb. I have this cycle, and can build that. And I have this function, which is strange, because well, first of all, we have a try catch. So the try catch in this case, when we have an error, catch everything and return a string error. So it's quite stupid also. And we have a big comment here. Why we have this function? Because, well, you know, Node uses two kinds of compiler. The first one is the first compiler and do the first compiling. And then there is a dynamic optimizer. The dynamic optimizer can do some kind of optimization. Typically, for instance, in this kind of code, it can inline call. So let's take another example, which is not this one, but is quite. Okay, now we have here two different JavaScript. This one, which is quite stupid, is simply a for loop, which do calls another function. And the other one is the same, but without the comment. So if we execute the first one, node size one, well, it took something like almost 2 seconds. Again, just to be sure, to make some, again, almost 2 seconds. The second one is maybe half, roughly half, okay? The only difference between those two files is the comment. So the first one is, how can you explain it? The explanation is that some dynamic optimization cannot be applied, are not applied, if the function text is more than 600 characters. So this will never be inlined because of the comment. So comments are not ignored. I mean, are ignored executing the code, but are not ignored for optimization. And this is something that you can see. So it's 10 minutes, correctly? 10 minutes, okay. And so it's something that you, well, if you don't know that, you probably can put a lot of code, a lot of comments. So every time everything says that you have to comment out your code, sometimes you don't have to comment out your code. So the point is, how do you know? How do you know if those functions are optimized or not, if V8 is able to dynamically optimize it? There are a couple of others V8 options. Let's try it. First, let's try it in this case because it's simpler. So we have to add minus minus trace inlining, minus minus trace deopt, minus minus trace opt. And then we can execute our size one, which has the comment. And what's that? Oh, sorry. Why size one? Why? Ah, yeah. Well, let's remove it. Okay. So what we see is that this is the interesting part. Did not inline add called from target test to big. So this means that V8, our crankshaft, which is the dynamic compiler inside the node, wasn't able to do this kind of optimization. Let's do the same on the other, which I repeat the same without the comment. You see, inlined add called from my function. So it's something that if you don't know this, well, it's quite hard to realize. So what we can do is simplify our code. Well, first, go back to our server.js and launch it. I grep hash because, well, there is a lot of stuff, API stuff, so I want only to see what happens here. I call my endpoint. And we see that there is another disabled optimization, because also try-catch statements are something that avoid V8 to optimize. So let's be quick, because we don't have so much time, and remove, first of all, remove this. It's useless. Useless. And, well, I need some time to do that, sorry guys. Probably with VI I was quicker. I'm quicker, but well. Is the problem that I don't have slides, so I had to do that all manually, but easy in the rules. Okay, almost done. And see. Okay. We don't see the optimization anymore. In this case, the function is still slow because it's stupid. But in other cases, well, that can help. So it's a way that we can. Is a tool that you can use well to see if actually all your code can be optimized by V8. So let's continue. What we can see now is that we can do CPI profile also with Chrome, so with our inspect server.js. Let's open it. Okay, we have some profiles. In profiles, we can record the JavaScript CPU profile. Let's try it. So let's again launch our firing with autocannon and start recording profile. I think we can stop it. As you can see, this is, all the function with the total time. And we see that there is our test data. And probably this is our super hash, which is the problem because we see that in almost 8 seconds, we spent 7 seconds on executing this super hash. We don't see our hash because we optimized it. So it has been inlined. If I go back, I don't because we don't have time, and I restore the try catch, it will appear because it's something that is executed as a function instead of being inlined in the caller. Okay. Okay. I don't know how much time we have, but I think that we have 5 minutes or so. Okay, perfect. Let's do some memory profiling. Memory profiling is tricky because it's something that developers don't do. They always, all the time, start and stop the application, so they don't find leaks. They don't also look for leaks. But it's quite normal in production to have this kind of problem. Something like, okay, we have to restart our application server every night. Why? Because otherwise, all the performance have a degradation. So it's quite important to identify them. It's not so easy. There is a couple of tools that we can use. First one is a module that is called the Memwatch. Okay, I can open the code with Atom so we are quicker. This is, again, the same file, of course. There is a module called Memwatch. One sec. I take from here. And it's basically a listener of memory leak events. So you put the require. And then at the end or everywhere in the application, you can add those two listeners for two events. The first one is stats, and the other one is leak. So now we can launch it. So let's launch it. And then, now, one more thing, because before... before doing that, it's better to lower this number, otherwise it's too slow the application, and it is harder to create the memory leak. So let's lower it and launch it. Almost done. So we have our server running at port. Let's launch AutoCannon again. This time with some more connection and with a longer time. As I said, identifying memory leaks is harder because we have to create a situation of load and to make the garbage collector works. And we are, okay, so sorry, one sec. I have to remove this one, otherwise we don't see memwatch stuff. Sorry, first, okay. Okay, so we see we are creating again the load with AutoCannon, and we see that Memwatch is creating some logs. What we can do right now is, we can take a heap snapshot. So, too much stuff, however, but. So, the debugger attached because I started DevTools on this, Chrome is still running, and then I will take another snapshot, probably when complete the processing. Okay, second snapshot, and see, we have a leak. Memwatch says, okay, if growth over 5 consecutive garbage collectors. So this is a way that we can have to instrument our application and detect this kind of situation. And so the point is, okay, we have a leak. How we can identify the leak? We have two consecutive snapshots, quite big memory, but 1 second is still calculating. One powerful feature, and then I completed the talk, so that is included in DevTool is that we can compare memory heaps. We can also load it, but it's probably easier to calculate them. And in this case, there is not so much difference because I took the choose snapshot to near. However, it's now calculated the snapshot. In my laptop is much, much quicker, but this is my daughter's laptop, so probably, okay. This is very interesting because this is the difference between this and this. And here you can see, well, what is changed. And okay, this is the leak. We are adding an object every time to this object to an array, which is useless. Of course, this is not the biggest object that we have in heap. Remember that in heap we have also stuff which is then collected by garbage collector. If you do that constantly with a bunch of snapshots, you can see that this object, well, raises every time. And that's it. I'm finished. Sorry.